everyone from X, your favorite alien. Alright, before we move on to the verification step, using another simple tool that will tell us whether those strange shapes truly have a reason to exist, I'd like to spend a moment clarifying something important. Those colorful bubbles we detected are not the polarities of the magnet, but rather the interactions that the magnet will have in relation to another dipole. Yes, because the use of the sensor that maps those shapes around the analyzed magnet is, in every respect, comparable to the interaction with another magnet, provided that, during the interaction, the same angle is always maintained, just as in the detection process. In other words, if I make two magnets interact in an axially parallel way, everything that happens corresponds exactly to what the related figure of the magnetic orbital tells us. In this case, this one, the atomic d orbital. But this topic goes much deeper, and we'll get back to it in the next videos. Now, in his research, Marcio created a very important image, the G16, which shows the differences between what he called the study boards and the dynamic boards. Yes, it may look like just a change in coloring, but this small detail can completely alter the meaning of the board. The study boards were conceived and colored to match the traditional illustrations found in textbooks describing the polarities of a magnet, showing us clearly where the north and south poles are located. This concept was then extended and applied to the strange shapes revealed through Hall effect sensor measurements. In fact, these images of magnetic orbitals, unlike the classic textbook ones, tell us that if we analyze a single magnet along its axis of magnetization, there will always be the main polarities, the large lobes, but also an inverted polarity emerging all around it, which in 3D would appear as a torus, extending even well above the diameter. Indeed, using the same detection method, Marcio gradually increased the length of the magnets in order to observe the behavior of this torus. And in this figure from his research, you can actually see how the elevation angle of the bubble above the diameter changes in direct relation to the length of the axis. So to wrap this part up, the study boards are specifically suited for the study of polarities and not of interactions. And this is where the dynamic boards come into play. But first, we need a premise, because these boards are way more important. And let me quote, "A complete representation of the polarities of a magnetic field is usually built to interact with what object?" Well, if we consider non-magnetic matter, which couldn't care less about polarity changes, we might say ferrous materials and similar. But logic demands the most accurate answer for the interaction with any other dipole. So if we treat these as interaction boards, we can actually use them as a kind of forecast, a prediction of what will happen if I bring another magnet close to the one under analysis, always keeping the same angle used for the Hall sensor detection. In this case, it was parallel to the magnetization axis. And this image right here shows exactly that, by comparing the two different kinds of boards. Now let's test it step by step. On the study boards, on the left, if I bring in another magnet with its south pole facing up, the very first interaction is repulsion between north and north. We assign it the red color. So far, so good. If I move the magnet further down and stop it exactly beside the analyzed magnet, I now have two simultaneous interactions. The first is attraction between south and north. We give it another color, say blue, and that's correct. But the second simultaneous interaction is also attraction between north and south. So, logically, I should assign the same blue color again, right? But the board gives us red, because once we've passed the magnet's diameter, everything is mirrored, just like the current textbook illustrations. If I keep moving further down, the last interaction also turns out wrong, because we now have two south poles facing each other. That means it should be red repulsion, the same as the very first interaction, not blue. So as we said, study boards are very useful for identifying the magnet's polarities and the strange shape of its field. But they cannot be used to predict the real dipole-to-dipole interactions. For that, we must look at the dynamic boards, the ones on the right. As you can see, these boards are not mirrored in their coloring, because we now account for the fact that once you cross the magnet's diameter, in dipole interactions, everything is inverted. Yes, but it's inverted for both magnets involved. And so, repeating the same experiment as before, we can observe that this time all the interactions are correctly represented, even in the colors. But why go through all of this? Well, the answer is truly important. Let's recap. 1, we have this new and strange shape of the magnetic field. 2, we know how to handle and therefore color the bubbles, so that the board gives us an exact prediction of how another dipole will interact. 3, by reconstructing these dynamic boards in 3D, we end up with the perfect shapes of all the families of known atomic orbitals. Now, the question we have to ask ourselves is, why? Probably, atomic orbitals govern subatomic interactions, and in the very same way, magnetic orbitals do the same here in our macroscopic world, even respecting the same geometry. It's no longer just a game of shapes, lobes, or donuts. Excuse me, do you want something? Sorry for the interruption. What I was saying is that it's the very same logic of interaction manifesting everywhere, from the magnet you hold in your hand to the electrons orbiting a nucleus. Nature seems to speak the same geometric language. Maybe we're not just observing a macroscopic phenomenon. Maybe we're actually peeking straight into the instruction manual of matter itself. Astonishing, isn't it? Perfect. In the next video, we'll see how to test and verify whether these bizarre shapes truly match the real interactions between dipoles. And of course, do you think everything I've explained so far comes from a sci-fi movie? Not at all. As you've seen in the previous videos, there's an experiment for every single word of this research. And if you'd like to ask questions or leave comments, please do. We're eager to discuss this with all of you. Oh, and if you want to subscribe, leave a like and share. That would be magnificent. Greetings to all humans from X, your favorite alien. Seriously.